we've decided to know, but that's all right, I'll handle those, thank you.
We must find ways of extending the post-work project. We shouldn't simply accept drudgery, but we must resist it in its waged or unwaged forms wherever we find it. So if we don't, then what we're calling post-work politics is really just post-job politics, and we can do better. So this is the moment where I shift from criticising stuff, the basis of every good academic job, to actually proposing something. So how? How do we do this? I think there are kind of several ways that we can integrate social reproduction into post-work imaginaries. So the first one is that we can kind of think of the home as a site of radical social and political transformation, rather than assuming that the domestic sphere is beyond the reach of our ambitions. Because when we think about politics and we think about political change, probably that's not the first place our mind goes to the spaces that we live in, to the relationships we have with our families or with the people that we kind of cohabit with. So I want to kind of change that. We could change the way we live and who we live with, for a start. The single family home is hugely labour intensive, and it's also very energy inefficient. So just think about how many people in this city alone cook individual dinners every single night, and using ingredients that they've each individually trekked to the shops to buy. And think about all the extra expense involved in buying just enough food for one person or one family, rather than buying in bulk. How many cookers are turned on in London at sort of around this time every night? How many kitchen lights are burning right now, and so on? So much work and so much waste. If we lived more collectively, so maybe in groups of 10 to 12 or something like that, rather than 1 to 4, what effect could that have? Can we imagine accommodation with not just kind of shared kitchens and shared laundries, the sort of practical things, but maybe shared libraries or shared media labs and facilities, music studios, workshops, healthcare facilities, and so on? It could mean that work could be shared out more efficiently between a greater number of people. And it could also mean that we'd be able to pool our resources to invest in top-of-the-line technologies. So, you know, we can have all mod cons for our communal gym, we can have super cool equipment for our, like, media labs, and we could also have labour-saving devices that to lessen the burdens upon us even further. If there's lots of people sharing one house, then it becomes much more cost-effective to invest in those technologies, and you may also have a different kind of space that accommodates different kinds of technologies. Now, okay, it's kind of important to acknowledge that perhaps this vision of living with, like, 9 other people doesn't match up to what you've imagined for yourself in the past. So maybe you've kind of had an image of your dream home that's based on privacy, it's based on independence, it's based on having a room of one's own and all that stuff. And perhaps you kind of just think that living with your biological family is the natural way of doing things. And I completely understand that point of view. But I also think it's really important to remember that the household as it currently stands, sort of typically in the form of the nuclear family, kind of in the popular imagination, if not in social reality, came into being largely through changes in working relationships. So expectations about what the family is and does have actually had a crucial role to play in determining things like wages, working hours, and public services. So one thing I like to use to illustrate that fact is the official poverty line in the US, so what's designated as being that poverty line, was designed on the basis that every family would include a housewife who could act as a kind of domestic manager, so do that kind of careful shopping, do the kind of skillful cooking, make all of the meals at home. And the reality, of course, is that many households have never had access to this kind of fantastic resource of the full-time home economist. And the cost of living is really much higher without that resource on hand. Detached from naturalising discourses of the private sphere and the family, it becomes painfully apparent just how unsatisfactory the home is as a place of work and how much domestic labourers might have to gain from resisting or agitating against it. Seeing the home in this way also encourages us to recognise where and how spatial arrangements and working practices might inform the visibility and the valuation of reproductive labour, like how we recognise it, what it counts for. Imagining different forms of social relations grounded in the home is also quite heartening for those of us who perhaps suffer from tense or unhappy or even abusive relationships with our biological families. And this is something that's experienced much more frequently by queer people. If we're imagining households beyond the family, we might be picturing the formation of self-selecting groups that are living together. So a mixture of relatives and friends and comrades and lovers. And these new kinds of family could be based on affinity, affection, and shared worldviews, rather than something as flimsy as genetic coincidence. It could also work as a form of resistance to intimate partner violence or domestic abuse, which tends to flourish in conditions of isolation and which really kind of thrives behind closed doors. So violence, rape, child abuse, that depends upon these kind of isolated sites. Those isolated sites of the single family home facilitate those kinds of abuse. Because victims can be better sort of detached from their support networks, and therefore they can be manipulated more easily. So where does this leave us? I'm going to sum this up. If we feel that something can and should be done to help mitigate the effects of current structures of oppression, then it makes sense to link up our struggles against gender oppression, including the unequal distribution of free time and domestic drudgery, to struggles against work. Indeed, what is required is in many ways a queer struggle, a struggle against the myth of naturalised, feminine or masculine character traits, and a single binary gender system which shapes the division of labour. Again, that's something that you guys very astutely picked up on earlier. For as long as the conventionally gendered, cis-hetero-patriarchal family dominates the horizons of our cultural imagination, I feel that work and temporal sovereignty, so the ability to dispose of one's time as one will continue to be unjustly apportioned. The left must cease framing our efforts as being on behalf of hard-working families. This is precisely what we should be struggling against. And instead, we must agitate for post-work, post-gender, post-capitalism. A lot of my favourite historical experiments in communal living never really got off the ground. So they were speculative, they were imagined, plans were drawn up, because I'm very interested in the architectural elements, so how you rethink space as a means of rethinking the social relations that take place within that space. So this idea of material hegemony, the way our buildings and our cities shape our political identities, what we think of as being possible. So I would strongly recommend reading Dolores Hayden's The Grand Domestic Revolution, which looks at feminist cooperative living from around the mid-1800s to the 1930s. So it's got a load of really great examples of things that could have happened, including really cool spaces which had been designed with communal kitchens and things like that, but also had been designed to reduce domestic labour. So, for example, rooms did not have corners. They were rounded, so they were easier to sweep. None of the hardware was shiny, so all of the, you know, your drawer handles and things were dull finished, so you didn't have to polish them. Windows could pivot, so cleaning them was easier. Baths were kind of fenced in for the first time, so you didn't have to clean underneath them or around them. So, you know, there's some cool examples of feminist stuff, but they were very often at a micro level. Part of this is precisely about re-engineering hegemony, and that is a much longer term and more substantial project than these little tiny eruptions that then left to fade. We have to collectively reorient our desires towards different ways of being together. Imagining the future is a tool for building a better present, because it is an affective technology. You know, and it's exactly what you were saying about feeling enabled to hope makes change seem more possible. So actually, all of this is not about imagining a world that's completely disconnected from now. It's using the future as a way of enabling change in the present. And it can also be a way of reckoning with the past. So understanding the histories of colonialism and environmental destruction and sexism and racism understanding that better, understanding those pasts better, give us a perspective in the present that allows us to imagine new futures. So it's a very, it isn't a linear temporality at all. There's something much more sort of looped.